Alright guys, here we're talking about season 3, episode 16 of The Twilight Zone.
I admire your ability to remember the number.
What did you think about this episode?
I like this episode.
Now, what would you, where would you, like, let's just go through it.
So I feel like you hate this episode.
Well, I'll get to my point.
Because you were like, well, or whatever. Ha ha, you fall into my trap.
So start us off here. How does this episode begin?
Oh, well, we got an old lady living alone in like a shut-in little place. And there's a wounded police officer outside, like, begging to be let in for help, as you do. He's been shot through some criminal thing you don't really see. And you come to find out she never leaves the house. She's never let anyone in. And and Death is like trying to trick her into opening her door so that he can take her and all.
Death
that stuff.
In many forms has been trying to trick her for years.
Exactly.
I think the moments like leading up to so you don't know what kind of world they live in, and that's what paints the picture for me in the beginning. Because she's in this house. She's surrounded by like furniture, trying to keep things away from her. The door is locked. Yeah. There's no window in the frame, but it's boarded up. It appears to be winter. She seems to be cold. There's snow
outside,
on the ground. But she has no windows in the frames. Like you know how cold this house would be?
Oh, you're saying there's just holes in the walls or whatever?
The windows themselves had no glass.
I don't even know if that was supposed to be in the fiction of the
world.
It
wasn't that they were glassless, like, oh, yeah. Drew Carey wears glasses. They were broken. There was no protection from the elements.
I did not even care about this at all.
It painted what I thought the world was going to be, because I did not remember this episode at all. I didn't remember it at all. So I'm watching this thing, and I'm like, okay, she lives in this, like, dilapidated building. There's like, you know, wood across the windows. There's no glass. I'm like, this must be, like, a post-apocalyptic thing. There's a person outside. What is this? He gets shot down in the street. Okay, further telling me that this must be some sort of a post-apocalyptic world. If this is just a thing that happens, like, you know. It's like, okay, he's a cop. Is he really a cop? Are there still cops? What do cops even do in the future?
Is he a robot cop from the future? Killing old ladies?
So
she's the last lady on earth?
Like, all right, she brings him in, and I'm like, all right, she doesn't seem to put any effort into healing him or taking care of any of his problems,
and he
doesn't really address his wounds almost at all. What kind of future is this?
I have a note or something, because it does, like, a fade and then comes back or whatever, and now he's, like, sitting up, and he makes a comment later, like, I have to get to a doctor, though, or whatever, but I'm like, did she nurse him back to health? Like, how is he, like,
because you're like, how long has this been? It's been 3 minutes.
Some time seems to have passed, but you're not sure.
And ultimately, the wounds are not real, because
ultimately,
he is Mr. Death.
He's Death himself.
But, like, then someone comes to the door, and she thinks that's Death. He breaks his way in, and you're pretty sure that he's not Death, because if Death could just break in, Death would just break in.
Exactly.
And he's
Death
a man saying
rules.
That this is, a, you know, it's modern day for them, so it's like 1961 or something.
Yeah.
And you know, this building's condemned. I'm like, okay, condemned. That's why it looks so shitty.
Right, she's like squatting in what the like burnt out remains of part of this place, right? Or she makes a comment like they've all moved away or years ago or whatever. Like, they fill in enough details that I'm kind of like, I understand how she's living and what's happening
or
whatever.
It backfilled decently enough, but I think where my mind was headed from that first, like, the opening shots, I'm like, in a world. And then it's like,
in a world,
that's just down the street.
An old lady. Yeah, so I must have remembered this more than I thought. I didn't think that I remembered this. Like, you know, once she starts talking, I was just like, oh, okay. But, like, I don't know if I just got it or if I was, like, remembering it. I don't feel like I like could remember this episode. Because even once things happen later, like I wrote down, like, why does the other guy not mention the cop? Why is the cop not saying, hey, help me or something? And I was like, okay. But I really like that. They gave you the opportunity as the audience to kind of figure it out, right? Because you're good, because she's focused on this man, and, like, so are you. And the cop's, like, right over there. And so it gives you that, you know, those moments of, like, wait a minute, he's right over there. Why is nothing happening with that guy?
I think
right
I would
now?
Have preferred a darker twist to the end. I think I would have liked, like, you know, when the guy, the contractor does push his way through and eventually gets to where he should see the cop just not being there. And then, like, her, like, where? And then he just, like, but he's, like, behind her as she closes the door. It took me a while, but I find, like, a monologue
but that was the, you need Christopher Walken for that. You need someone to be like,
no, it was
whatever.
A different tone. It was like,
exactly,
you know, that's just how I think I would have preferred, because it had the ability to be creepy.
Sure.
And, not often do we get that deep creepy that we from the Twilight Zone, but when we do, I think it's so cool.
The tone is what like made it for me by the end.
Where
he was like, hey, what you thought would be an explosion is really just a whisper. Like, cause like, you know, I can see your way, and that's what I was like expecting. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, he didn't like immediately kill her because he, you know, this is his white whale, and he wants to like torture her and bring her down or whatever. So it was so like refreshing and weird to have him be like, no, I'm coming in, like, you know, I'm gonna like trick you and then give you the needle, like I'm like the doctor with the puppet
it's
or whatever.
It's a little strange though that death's rules, like death can be thwarted by a simple lock. Like what would hold out death doesn't hold out a contractor. Like it's a little strange. And I would have liked to have known more of the lore, or if she had like books that she was flipping through or like something on those
ancient
things.
Sumerian texts wrote of a death man that could shapeshift.
Like what if you just it was your time to die and you were in prison or something? Could death just not get to you?
So I don't know about the full logistics of the whole world or whatever, but like I'm assuming her ability to see him coming and like react was the difference between everyone else and him, right? That everyone, whether you know, even if you're in solitary, you get out once a day and there's guards and there's whoever, and you know one of them's death or something like that, or like the doctor at the place for your checkup.
Do you think by those means that like death is like Mr. Smithing somebody and he temporarily takes them over?
I don't know.
Or is death just a person who can change his features? Because if he's just a person who can change his features, he wouldn't necessarily be able to slip into places slip into.
So she
regardless.
Said something about like only she can see him, I think.
That's because she
like
was
that.
Closer to the veil or whatever because she's older.
So it might be this weird
thing. Oh, like
thing
he's
where
completely invisible to everybody else?
Something. I don't know. But you know, like I'm okay with like the level of presentation because you get to take this neat little ride where she says, oh, and last week he was from the gas company and then he was from from the city saying I had to move, I'm not moving, and all of a sudden you're like, oh god, she's just crazy. Could she just be crazy? And he's like, ma'am, what? Like, oh god, like, you know, this whole thing, and you're like, oh no, this is great. And then it kind of shifts again where she then goes into like the backstory, this lady on the bus and someone sat down next to her and all these things and all that stuff.
Yeah.
And I kept seeing him and all that stuff, and you're like, okay, maybe something's there. And then later she's like, you know, he keeps changing what he looks like. And it's like, how do you know you keep seeing him then? Are you just crazy?
Yeah,
what's
and that
going
kind
on?
Of thing is in a lot of things. Yeah. I just know.
Yeah,
or I
yeah.
can see it in the eyes.
Right.
He gives off an aura. The Spider-Man stuff.
Right. I have a spidey sense. My husband, Ben, used to tell me. Yeah. No, I liked this actress, and even the guy was okay, and they have this nice, like, back and forth and all that stuff. Like,
no, the acting was good on this episode.
It was, like, heartwarming to me. I felt really good about this. Usually, it is, like, I I'm a man who loves dark. I love horrible, like, hopeless. We fought all movie or all episode to, like, get out of a place, and it turns out, you know, that was only the first of, like, 20 levels of hell, and we're still trapped there for the rest of our life. Like, that's awesome to me, too. But this was a nice little thing.
No, it was a nice little contained episode. There are little things that I think I would have enjoyed to make it better, but on the whole, it wasn't a bad episode.
You could have turned it into all those horrible dark things too. And usually, when people veer away from that, you end up turning it into something where I'm like, okay, this wasn't an episode. This was corny. Or
I think
dumb
this the premise of this. If you took this script, you could make it into a very interesting like hour and a half long movie with like you know kids coming to visit their grandma and like grandma's fucking crazy and it's like no, it really is a thing. Maybe it's not death. It's like you know a demon or something. But like the bones of this do something
bones.
For me where I'm like, all right, I'm down.
Yeah, I really enjoyed the reveal, even though it was a dumb mirror thing. But I really liked, like, this has, like, a filmmaking aspect to it. Like, she's, like, grabbing the bars of her bed, like she's trapped in, like, life or whatever. And there's all those things. It was, like, inspirational in, like, a weird way. Because, you know, it's like, she's like, well, this isn't living, but I also don't want to die, right? And then, like...
Yeah, and that's a thing that's with, like, a lot of, like, post-apocalyptic thing or alien invasion things. It's like, well, you're technically still alive.
We're surviving.
And every moment alive is precious. And you are fighting for that, for the hope that eventually it'll be better. But you don't know that it's ever going to get better.
Right.
You could just be living your worst life for as long as possible until you just peter out and die.
And you have to fight until your fingers bleed just to get through another day of, like, we don't have enough water, there's zombies, or there's, like, military shooting robots killing us, right?
I wonder where her money and stuff came from, because she would, you know, leave money out for the kid. The kid would give her the food. Yeah.
There's a bit of holes with that kind of stuff.
How does that how do you even start that thing?
I know. And what
she doesn't have a phone.
And doesn't that kid eventually get old enough where he's no longer interested in doing this or something? And just
he might be the boy from the supermarket.
Oh, okay, okay. A boy delivers it for me.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I pictured it just being like a random kid she found. Hey, you, bring me food. I did a whole thing. There's awesome monologue dialogue stuff where even the contractor, like, he uses the tearing down of the building as, like, a metaphor for her, like, life. Like, well, the old has to make room, you know, has to leave and make room for the new. That's how, it's the circle of life.
Yep.
And all that stuff.
The most horrifying part about this episode for me was when
is our inevitable deaths waiting for
us? Oh, no. That's a sweet, sweet release.
Okay.
Was when he says, you've got an hour. Any possessions you want to take with you, you should grab now. And I'm like, oh, my God, an hour to empty all my possessions?
Oh, okay.
That would be horrifying.
She doesn't have
and
many
with nowhere
possessions,
to go.
Though.
Oh, she was full of clutter and chairs.
I mean,
I'm sure some of those are
possessions?
Sentimental.
Okay.
But that type of situation where I'm like, oh, my God, where would you go? What would you do? You have an hour? You're old?
Yeah.
Like, that's horrifying.
That's the main thing, and I think that's the whole point is, like, you know, death in his omniscience or whatever came then because he's like, okay, like you know, this is like a fork in the road of your life. This building's going to get torn down around you. You're going to be, like, impaled on rubble, or you're going to be dragged out and, like, thrown into the snow, and they're going to be like, I don't know, lady, go down to the church or something. We don't know. Like, she's nowhere to go. She's
like
no
the jerk
one.
With your chair and your lamp and your thermos just
that's all I need. Yeah, you're just gonna be out there, right? She has nowhere to go. She literally has no one, no family, right? Nothing or whatever.
Yeah.
And Death's like, listen, like, it's time. And she's like, you know what it is.
I like your thought of Death's timetable, like, nah, let me hook you up.
I don't know, like his approach seemed so, like, benevolent and, like, soft. And, like, he's not stalking people to, like, you know, reap their souls. He's just kind of going and doing his thing and, like, taking care of the death thing or whatever, right? It was, like, a nice death. It reminded me of...
Hers was, yes. But there's somebody, like, on their, like, bar mitzvah, they're reading a little book and then and they're just killed.
Yes, you have to die the way you
die. Well, you had an option. Become man now or die, right?
I'm sure he has, like, his own, you know, there's always some similar monologue or thing you can give or, like, whatever. Mm-hmm. There was a thing in, like, Sandman, you know,
Neil Gaiman.
Yeah, Neil Gaiman. Morpheus is, you know, is Dream, and one of his sisters is Death.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a whole plot line throughout the books of, like, this dude who is just like, I'm not interested in this whole Death thing. And, like, throughout the years seeing him, because she's like, okay, that's interesting, and doesn't take him for a while. And he lives, like, hundreds of years or something like that. It's this whole thing. But that whole concept of, like, you know, someone coming to, like, collect, and you find your ways of getting, like, an extension. Or he's like, I'm going to get you eventually, and you've been dodging me, and that's cute and everything like that, but now it's really, you know, time. And I'm going to
die.
And I'm not just going to, like, wait until you're lying in the snow and just, like, die. I'm going to go in and be like, listen, you know, hey, you were talking to me. I'm, like, a nice dude, right? This isn't bad, right? Take my hand. This is okay. And she was like, oh, and, like, all that stuff. Like, that was nice.
Yeah.
This made me feel like, oh, happiness in the world.
I assure you, your death will not be like this. It'll be more like Ghost, where, like, 17,
horrible,
you know,
demons
shadow men
drag
will
me
drag
down
you down
hell.
The street. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. No, I know, but that's why this was such a nice, like, oh, it might not be horrible, even though, because death is so horrible, like, generally speaking, and how stuff fits into our lives. This was a neat little, nice little thing.
It'll be a very similar thing where death comes in. He's a shot cop on your thing. You give him a nice cup of coffee. He throws it in your face, grabs your arm. Yeah, come out with me.
Shatters the mug, takes a broken piece, and just starts cutting me. And I'm like, oh, God.
Yeah.
It'll be
the course,
like,
of months and weeks, and then bam, down.
No, I was going to say, it'll be like our version of this, not this nice version of this or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, final thoughts on this episode? It was decent.
High marks, thumbs up. I think I liked it more than you. It's not outstanding. It isn't, like, top 10, but this is definitely one that I would put into my, like, list of
stuff.
It's
in the top half of Twilight Zones, I would say. I could have used one more meaty time period driven dialogue, like those long.
Now listen here, see.
But yeah, no, it was a good episode. Let us know in those comments what you thought about it. Don't die in a fire, and we'll see you next time.
Hello, internet. I just love watching Just Daggers. If you've enjoyed this video as much as I have, click that subscribe button. Peace out, homies.